Good morning. My name is Sisi Wu. I'm one of the co-chairs for the 14th annual Duke University Energy Conference. I'm really honored to really welcome you here. The discussion this morning has been already very energizing, so thank you for making the way. Planning a conference takes a village, so I'm very proud to have worked with this incredible group of talented and passionate energy MBA students to put on the programming for you today. You'll hear from some of them throughout the day on what really gets them excited about the energy industry, and also if you have questions, these are the faces that you want to remember throughout. We have an incredible list of 18 industry experts that will be sharing their perspective throughout the day, and you will, as audience, be able to interact with them throughout by submitting questions to Slido and uploading different questions. In fact, I would love to start if you guys can take out your iPhones and scan this code and just give us some perspective on what energy topic really motivated you to attend today. Before we dive into the program, I want to take an opportunity to thank our sponsors, NextEra, AES, PwC, Eight Rivers, Baywa, Chevron, Schneider Electric, Southern California Edison, Apex Clean Energy, ExxonMobil, and Advanced Energy. Without their generosity, this day would not have been possible, and we encourage you to interact with them throughout to learn about all the amazing things that they're doing in the industry. According to the IPCC, the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, we're sitting in an existential decade in terms of addressing the climate crisis. We must reduce our emissions by 43% by 2030 in order to limit global warming by 1.5 degrees. I think we all know at this point what is at stake if we don't meet these goals. From the historic floods in Pakistan this year that caused 1,700 casualties and over 2.1 million left homeless, to the historic drought globally that's already left 38 billion in damages, this is gonna be our reality until we take drastic action. Luckily for us, there are many public and private sector stakeholders that are already stepping up. Over 70 of the biggest public organizations have already set net zero achievement targets, and 140 countries are considering the same. In our own backyard, Duke University this fall actually announced its own climate commitments, uniting our education, research, and operations missions to the relentless pursuit of climate change solutions. As you can tell, from no matter where you are in your industry or career, these topics and goals are going to be affecting our business decisions from now on. This is by no means an easy feat, and we all know there's no silver bullet in the climate, addressing climate crisis. But one common theme that many people agree upon is the first step of electrifying everything. Everything that's currently using fossil fuels for energy source needs to be transitioned to electricity, so that we can set up the pace to decarbonize our power system. This power system is what generates and transmits electricity and is a model built on isolated power plants that transmits through long distances to customers like us today in this beautifully well-lit auditorium in Janine. Of course, this model hasn't changed significantly in the last 100 years, in part to the fact that it has provided reliable power to fuel critical processes like hospitals, or economic processes. I think that's one of the most popular arguments that people will bring up when we talk about introducing renewables or intermittent generation. And those people include my parents. We often argue about the path of the energy transition, and in part because they built their career building a reliable grid in China and understand the delicate balance of introducing innovation in a grid that needs to stay reliable. And in that case, electricity still has ways to go. Here's a photo of my mom, very vintage and fresh out of her master's program, which she likes to remind me was engineering and not an MBA. But she was joining, at the time, a state-owned utility and really charting her career. But for me, even though I was, you know, introduced to this industry at a young age, I was not motivated to join, but perhaps because I was, like many, rebelling against becoming our parents. But after joining the Nicholas School of the Environment and the Fuqua School of Business, I realized that energy can be the solution, and the time to build the grid of tomorrow is today. This is actually the most opportune time that we could be talking about this deep dive conversation. The context of this year has really moved the discussion towards this space from the war on Ukraine that has really renewed the conversation of the switch to clean energy and removing off fossil fuels as a national security measure, to the IRA, the Inflation Reduction Act, authorizing over $400 billion in clean energy spending. We're incredibly excited to welcome the 18 speakers today to really discuss the topic at hand. You'll hear from longtime industry experts, Audrey Zibelman, for our afternoon keynotes. Audrey has spent her career in both the public and private sector, from roles like the chair of the New York Public Service Commission to the executive position of PJM, as well as the CEO of the Australian Energy Market Operator. She currently advises for X, the Moonshot Company, and RMI, and continues to be a driver of clean energy transition worldwide. You'll hear from companies like SmartWires, EDF Renewable, Schneider Electric, and Cypress Creek Renewables on what exactly is needed still to modernize the grid, and from startups like TerraPower, Form Energy, and NetPower, who are building the next generation of energy supply. We'll also hear from FreeWire, NLX, and Neighborhood Sun on how the demand side of the grid is changing and how that impacts the overall system. And to round out the conversation, we'll have finance experts from Marathon Capital, Apollo Global Management, and Glenmont Partners, who are managing the global energy investments, and will share some of the challenges that still exist. We're also incredibly lucky to have many Duke alumni join us today, including Jenna Weiner and Tim Singer, who's charted their career into the energy industry, and will share some of their tips for the group at hand. I know this shows seems like a lot. There's a lot of ways to tackle this problem, and I think the audience likely is coming from us from different perspectives of all. So if we look at the Slido results, we'll see that a lot of people are passionate about this, and there's multiple ways to tackle the energy transition. And I hope that we will be able to address many of these topics throughout the day.